Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Red Hammer, V Plague Book 4, by Dirk Patton. Narrated by Jeffrey Kafer. Take the children and yourself and hide out in the cellar. By now the fighting will be close at hand. Don't believe the church and state and everything they tell you. Mike and the Mechanics, Silent Running. Chapter 1. Army Master Sergeant Darius Jackson stood leaning out over the narrow platform on the edge of the slow-moving locomotive, watching John Chase plummet more than 80 feet to the brownish-gray water of the Mississippi. There was a large splash, then the Major disappeared beneath the swirling surface of the river. "Crazy motherfucker," Jackson said to himself, staring at the spot where the Major had gone under. He wanted to stand there and see if the insane man surfaced, but he needed to get the train stopped and reversed. There were still evacuees back on the Memphis side of the bridge that hadn't boarded when the deserter, Air Force Captain Lee Roach, had hijacked the train. In a struggle with Rachel and Dog, the three of them had fallen off the train, past the bridge and into the flood-swollen river below. Major Chase had immediately gone in after them. Shaking his head, Jackson slung the Major's rifle with his own and stepped into the locomotive cab to figure out the controls. It only took him a couple of minutes to get the train stopped, but several more to get it in reverse and moving back toward Memphis. While he worked, he was in radio contact with his CO, Colonel Crawford, somewhere above him in a Black Hawk helicopter.
"He did what?"
The tone of incredulity was clear in the Colonel's voice.
"He jumped off the goddamn train and into the river, sir. Guess I should have listened to him and killed Roach when we captured him." "Don't waste time second-guessing yourself, Master Sergeant. We're peeling off to see if we can spot them in the water. Get those people out of there. The Hummers and Bradley are almost out of ammo." "Yes, sir. Out."
While the train rolled backwards on the bridge, Jackson opened the side door, reached out, and tugged the large rear-view mirror into alignment. Roach had knocked it out and down to prevent Jackson and Major Chase from seeing inside the cab as they approached. Mirror in proper adjustment, he was able to see down the side of the train. Over 1,000 people still stood on the bridge decking, as far away from the Humvees and Bradley that were guarding the entrance as they could get. All three vehicles were firing their machine guns, the Bradley also utilizing its chain gun to stop the infected, and there was a respectable pile of shattered bodies in a semicircle around the approach to the bridge. Eyes on the mirror and hand on the throttle, Jackson slowed the train as the rearmost car reached the part of the bridge that had solid decking beneath the rails. This is where the panicked evacuees waited, and he slowed further. Fully on the solid portion of the bridge, Jackson cut the throttle to idle and set the brakes for the train cars and the four locomotives. Immediately, people surged forward, climbing into the waiting cattle cars that were all that was left of the original train. The people loaded themselves quickly, frightened, but still willing to help each other. Jackson watched them climb on in the big mirror, willing them to move faster. The chain gun on the Bradley fell silent, and a moment later one of the Hummer's machine guns ran dry as well. That left one Humvee-mounted machine gun and the machine gun on the Bradley still in the fight. The greater destruction of the Bradley's chain gun had equaled the firepower of at least three machine guns, and with it out of ammo, the wall of infected quickly pushed forward. The semicircle of clear space around the entrance began rapidly shrinking. Jackson got on the radio with the soldiers holding the line, asked a few questions, then started issuing orders. Momentarily, he saw the majority of the men and women manning the vehicles exit and start running for the train. Once they had a 100-yard head start, the Hummer that still had some ammo and the Bradley started following them out onto the bridge deck, machine guns still firing to keep the infected at bay. By the time the running soldiers reached the rear of the train, all the civilian evacuees were loaded. Even in the cab of the giant locomotive, Jackson could hear them screaming for him to start moving. The two military vehicles came to a stop 20 yards behind the rearmost car, the Hummer's machine gun going silent. The infected surged, but only covered a few yards before a Black Hawk swooped in and opened up with its door-mounted minigun. The helicopters were very low on ammo, and Jackson had held them in reserve for just this moment. He was determined to get all the soldiers on the train. The leading ranks of infected fell under the withering minigun fire. The heavy high-velocity slugs tore through bodies, the steel of the bridge, anything they touched. The remaining soldiers wasted no time in abandoning the two vehicles and running for their lives.
As soon as Jackson saw their boots at the bridge deck, he throttled up the diesels, ready to go the second the running defenders were on board. They'd only covered half the distance when the minigun ran out of ammo. Dozens of female infected screamed and immediately sprinted past the devastated bodies. They didn't make it far as the Blackhawk peeled off and dropped towards the river as an Apache took its place and opened up with its chin-mounted chain gun. Jackson smiled, watching the leading edge of infected dissolve as the explosive rounds hit in their midst. Pulling his attention back to the fleeing soldiers, he released the brakes when he saw the last man climb on. Managing the controls, he advanced the throttle. Jackson didn't know what he was doing and was a bit intimidated by the complicated control panel, scanning the myriad gauges and warning lights. But he figured that as long as he kept everything in the green, he was okay. Manipulating the throttle and the controls that fed the electricity generated by the diesels to the drive motors, he successfully kept everything working, and soon the train was moving at 25 miles an hour. That was fast enough to prevent any infected from catching up and boarding, which was good as Jackson wasn't comfortable with pushing the speed any higher. The bridge across the river was 4 miles long, and it took nearly 10 minutes to cross the span. On the Arkansas side, the infected were not nearly as numerous and had been held back by a Blackhawk and Apache helicopter. Bodies were piled several feet high on the track, but the heavy train pushed them aside without so much as a shudder. They continued on into the flat countryside, rice paddies stretching out as far as the eye could see on either side of the tracks. Jackson looked over his left shoulder, through the thick windows of the locomotive. Above the middle of the river, more than a mile downstream from the bridge, a pair of Blackhawks were slowly moving south, apparently still searching for the people in the water. They were too high to be conducting a rescue. Jackson had been raised in Mississippi, not too far down the river, and he well knew the power of the water. Very few people had ever gone into the river and come out alive. A rumble of explosions sounded over the heavy throb of the locomotive's diesel. Shifting his gaze to the large external mirror, he watched as two Apaches fired multiple Hellfire missiles into the midspan of the bridge. The structure was no match for the warheads, which cut through the steel with ease. Less than a minute after the bombardment began, nearly a mile of girders and tracks broke free and fell into the river below, preventing the hundreds of thousands of infected in Memphis from crossing to the west. Reaching to his neck, Jackson worked his fingers under his uniform to grasp the small gold cross his mother had given him the day he enlisted in the army. Saying a prayer, he rubbed the cross with his thick thumb, turning his attention back to the track in front after a heartfelt amen. Chapter 2.
"Oh, shit!"
flashed through my head a half a second after I leapt off the train. The bottom of the bridge was 65 feet above the surface of the Mississippi River, and with the height of the bridge, deck, and locomotive, I was going to fall at least 85 feet before hitting the water. From that height, it was likely I could be seriously injured or killed if I impacted the water on my back or stomach. Rachel had gone in feet first. I hadn't seen how Dog impacted and didn't give a shit about Roach. Well, actually, I hoped he did a face plant and the river finished him off. I recalled from jump school, when I was learning to use a parachute, that there's something called terminal velocity. That is when a falling object cannot fall any faster because of the resistance of the atmosphere as the object passes through it. Wind resistance, in other words. A man who is positioned horizontally will reach terminal velocity very quickly, in about the first 40 or 50 feet of the fall, since there is a large area of the body creating drag. Falling feet or head first greatly decreases drag, and you fall faster and take longer to reach terminal velocity. I couldn't remember the numbers, but I knew I needed to go in feet first to have a decent chance of surviving. The drop seemed to take forever. I had time to notice how the surface of the river appeared swollen. It roiled with eddies and looked like dirty liquid steel. I tried to spot where Rachel and Dog had impacted, but the water wasn't giving up any clues. As I continued to fall, I clamped my ankles together as tightly as I could and pointed my toes down. A couple of moments before impact, I raised my arms straight over my head so they wouldn't be yanked up when I hit and leave me with two dislocated shoulders. In the last moment before hitting, I squeezed my butt cheeks together as hard as possible. I've heard stories of water being forced up a jumper's anus upon impact, and while I didn't know if that's true or even possible, I sure as hell didn't want to find out by getting a Mississippi River enema. Hitting the water was far less dramatic than I expected. Perhaps my body position was exactly as it should have been, or maybe it's really not that bad from 85 feet. Either way, I knifed through the surface and deep into cold darkness. Immediately upon entering the water, I twisted my body and spread my arms and legs to create drag and slow my descent. The river was shockingly cold, much colder than I ever would have expected for the middle of summer. My body wanted to gasp in reaction to the sudden temperature change, and I barely managed to stop myself from inhaling as I continued to sink. The current was strong. I could feel it pulling me along, and I quickly became disoriented as I tumbled into the water. Forcing myself to stay calm, I started swimming. I was heading for a lighter-looking area, even though I had initially thought the surface was in the opposite direction. With enough light to see, I let a few air bubbles trickle out of my nose and was glad to see them rush in the direction I was already going. Lungs burning, I swam harder, suddenly breaking through the surface and gulping air. Looking around, I had to dive and swim frantically to avoid a large log that was spinning in one of the surface eddies. Breaching the surface again, I swam to it and hooked an arm over its top, using its buoyancy to hold me up while I surveyed my situation. I was on the western side of the middle of the river, and the current had already carried me a couple of hundred yards south of the bridge. That was about all I could see other than water. My head was only a foot or so above the surface, and while I could see land on either side of the river, I couldn't see the banks from that low in the water. Holding on to the log, I let it spin me through a full 360 degrees, hoping to see a head bobbing in the water. Nothing. I tried climbing up onto the log to gain elevation and a better view, but it had been in the river a while and was slippery with slime. I couldn't get a grip on it to pull myself any higher. Still spinning and watching, I started shouting Rachel's name, pausing to listen every few seconds. No answering shout. I didn't know what to do. I had jumped without thinking, panic and fear at seeing Rachel and Dog go into the water, driving any reasoning out of my head. My makeshift raft was still spinning slowly, and as I faced to the north once again, I was surprised at how much farther downstream I was. Absently noting that the train had reversed and was heading back to the east, I forced myself to calm down and think through my options. Rachel and Dog had gone off the train about 15 seconds at the most before I had jumped. That meant they were likely to my east, as the train had been rolling west at the time. Was the current stronger or weaker where they'd entered the water? Were they ahead of me or behind me? I had no way of knowing. I was preparing to abandon the log and strike out across the water to the east, when a blackhawk roared into a hover directly above me. I looked up and could see two heads leaning out of the side door, staring at me. One of them waved, and I waved back with my free arm. Moments later, a weighted rope splashed into the water 20 feet downstream. Riding the log, I released just before coming abreast of the line and swam a few strokes before grabbing on. The rotor wash was fierce, churning up the water and blinding me, but this was an old drill and I soon had a foot firmly shoved into a loop and a death grip on the rope. I released my hold long enough to twirl a hand in the air, then grabbed tight as the pilot gained altitude and plucked me out of the river. The Blackhawk headed straight to the western shore, where I was deposited on a tall levee that separated the river from what looked like endless miles of rice paddies. Stepping away from the rope, I shielded my eyes as the helicopter descended to pick me up. It came to a hover a few feet off the ground, dirt and debris swirling around it, and I dashed forward. Hands reached out the open side door and pulled me in as I scrambled up, the pilot spinning us around and gaining altitude over the river before my legs were all the way inside the aircraft. Captain Blanchard reached out and snapped a safety tether onto the vest before dragging me the rest of the way in, where Colonel Crawford waited. One look at his face and I knew I was in for an ass-chewing.
"Are you dumber than a fucking box of rocks, or do you just have a death wish?"
he roared in my face, clearly audible over the noise of the helicopter even without benefit of headphones.
"I've seen some fucked up shit in my day, but you take the goddamn cake. 20 fucking helos flying around up here that can actually fucking see what's in the goddamn river. But like a dim-witted moron, you go and jump in the fucking water. I swear to God, you don't have the brains of the turd I flushed this morning. If I didn't need you, I'd bust your ass back to No Nuts Private and let you clean latrines for the jarheads."
I looked back at him for a few moments, watching him breathe heavily as the anger boiled inside.
"Wow, sir, you sound just like my old command sergeant major. He could chew ass and spit out like no one I've ever met."
I grinned, calculating my response would defuse the situation and not prompt the colonel to carry through with his threat. "Oh well, I've been a private before.
There are worse things in the world. Captain Blanchard stared at me with his mouth hanging open in disbelief. Crawford clenched his jaw, his face going even redder for a moment, before barking out a laugh and letting out a huge sigh.
You are a pain in the ass, Major. A 5-star, big-bald, tiny-brained pain in my ass.
The colonel turned away with a shake of his head to speak to the pilot. Blanchard sat there like he was at a tennis match, head moving back and forth as he looked from me to the colonel. Dismissing the incident from my mind, I turned and stuck my head out of the door to look down at the river. We were now about a mile south of the bridge and moving slowly downstream no faster than the current was flowing. To my east, I could see another Blackhawk matching our speed and direction. I was mildly surprised that Colonel Crawford was devoting 2 of his assets to search for 1 woman and 1 dog, but wasn't about to look the gift horse in the mouth. I looked to the north when a rumble of explosions reached me, watching as 2 Apaches fired missiles at the bridge. Moments later, a huge section of the midspan collapsed into the water with a massive splash. Movement to the west caught my attention, and I turned my head to look at a large flight of helicopters approaching, skimming the surface of the rice paddies. There were at least 2 dozen aircraft in the flight, and I wondered why the colonel had called in more air support. As the helos approached the river, they broke into 3 groups, 2 of which quickly gained altitude, while the 3rd appeared to be accelerating directly at the train which had just reached the western shore. They looked like they were on an attack run, which didn't make sense. You didn't make runs on the infected. You hovered and hosed them down. Glancing around the interior of the Blackhawk, I spied a pair of tethered binoculars, scrambled across the deck to grab them, and returned to the door. Focusing on the newly arriving helicopters, I was completely unprepared for what I saw. So unprepared that at first I didn't believe what I was seeing. Thinking I had to be mistaken, I shifted the glasses to an Apache to compare. I wasn't mistaken. The design was similar, but these weren't Apaches. Lowering the binoculars, I reached out and grabbed Colonel Crawford, pulling him to the open door and shoving them into his hands. I pointed, and he looked, freezing when he saw the helos. The Apache pilots in the area had noticed the intruders and turned to meet them, several of them firing missiles as they raced forward.
"What's going on?"
Captain Blanchard had moved to squat right behind me and was peering over my shoulder.
"The goddamn Russians are here," Crawford answered before I could say anything.
Chapter 3. Russian President Alexei Baranov looked around the large conference room adjacent to his office in the Kremlin. The room was filled to capacity with senior politicians, generals, admirals, and all of the associated aides that came with busy, powerful men. Baranov was not young, but his hair was still a thick mop of white that framed a broad peasant face. He was short with a blocky build, the $8,000 custom-tailored Armani suit he wore managing to make him seem almost elegant. Glancing at the gold Rolex on his left wrist, he compared it to the official clock on the wall of the conference room, satisfied that his aide had properly synchronized them down to the second. Alexei had grown up in a poor village on the slopes of the Ural Mountains during the time of Soviet rule. He may have been born a peasant, but he had been blessed with a very high IQ and a canny mind. At only 5 years of age, he had watched as the KGB rolled into his tiny town to arrest a man who had complained about the government's seizure of the meager crops he had produced on a small plot of land. He had only been trying to feed his family. Rather than frightened or aghast, Alexei had been in awe of the man dressed all in black, driving a shiny black Volga sedan. He decided that day to become one of them when he was old enough. Baranov joined the right youth groups, consistently impressing the group leaders with his vocal and rabid support of the Kremlin and all things Soviet. By his early teens, he had been noticed by the right people and plucked out of abject poverty to attend the Stalin School for Boys in Moscow. He soon became the schoolmaster's favorite, regularly informing on his classmates that exhibited anything less than absolute zeal for the Soviet way of life. Upon graduation, he received a glowing recommendation from the schoolmaster, who happened to be the brother-in-law of a colonel in the KGB. Young Alexei realized his dream at the tender age of 17, taking the oath of loyalty to the most brutal intelligence agency the world had ever seen. His rise in the ranks of the KGB was meteoric, joining the Communist Party and becoming a full colonel by his 35th birthday. Alexei was on the cusp of becoming a major general when the Soviet Union fell. Suddenly, the power he had wielded was so diminished it was as if it had never been. Not one to despair, he aligned himself with the criminals that quickly took all but political control of Russia in the absence of the heavy boots of the Soviet government. He grew enormously wealthy, cultivating friends and assassinating enemies in the shadows. When Vladimir Putin came to power as Russia's strongest leader since Brezhnev, Baranov rode his coattails into the Kremlin. The hammer and the spear behind Putin, he was ruthless in silencing any dissent and quickly became the most feared man in Russia. Alexei blamed the Americans for ultimately causing the fall of his beloved Soviet Union and had been plotting his revenge for decades. Unable to reconcile that the United States had won the Cold War, he approached his counterpart within the Chinese government with a plan to finally destroy America. Science had finally progressed to the point where he felt he could achieve his goal without risking the destruction of Russia by American nuclear weapons. Diverting hundreds of millions of U.S. dollars, the Chinese wouldn't accept rubles, Alexei seduced highly placed men within the Chinese Communist Party to participate in his plot. Not only to develop the nerve agent slash virus combination, but to execute the actual operation. To take the blame and the brunt of the American response. But for his plan to work, Baranov needed to have control of the Russian military. While even generals trembled at the mention of his name, he couldn't order the armed forces to do anything. For that, he needed presidential authority. A year before the Chinese launched the attacks, Alexei found an opportunity to have a private late-night meeting with Putin. A vodka drinker in public, Putin preferred single malt whiskey in private. Baranov arrived for their meeting with a $100,000 bottle of Glenfiddich single malt whiskey in hand. The alcohol had already been laced with a lethal dose of polonium-210, a radioactive isotope that was undetectable by the Kremlin's radiation detectors, as it gives off no gamma rays, and the alpha rays emitted are so weak they couldn't pass through the heavy glass bottle that held the whiskey. Alexei abstained from drinking during his meeting with Putin, and 3 weeks later, the Russian president died of a mysterious ailment. Alexei ensured there was no investigation into the cause of death. Within 24 hours of Putin's passing, Baranov seized control of the Russian government and installed himself as the new president. Within a week, it removed all opposition through a series of assassinations and bribes. The last part of his plan was in motion.
Comrade President, the missiles are within 1 minute of targets. Operation Red Hammer is on schedule.
Air Marshal Ludnikov, a staunch supporter of Baranov, spoke from the chair immediately to the president's right. Alexei looked up at the Chinese-made OLED screen that covered an entire wall of the conference room. It was divided into five sections. The left half was a real-time satellite image of the United States, zoomed so that an area stretching from West Virginia to Colorado was in frame. The right half of the screen was split into four equal parts. Each quarter was the view from the nose of an orbital-launched, deep-penetrator missile carrying an 80-kiloton nuclear warhead. Newly developed, each missile accelerated out of orbit, reaching near hypervelocity speeds prior to impact. Tests had confirmed that the weapons were capable of penetrating over 100 feet into Earth, or up to 40 feet of hardened concrete. Everyone in the room was anxious to see the results of the fabulously expensive development effort that Baranov had started more than a decade ago. Two targets within the continental U.S. were digitally circled in red on the left-hand screen. Target one was a hardened bunker deep inside Mount Weather in the West Virginia mountains. Well-paid spies within the White House staff had confirmed that this was where the U.S. president and the surviving members of Congress had fled. Target 2 was Cheyenne Mountain in the Rocky Mountain Range in Colorado, where the vice president and military leadership from the Pentagon had taken refuge after the Chinese attacks. In each of the quarter screens that showed the view from the missiles, a small digital timer blinked in the corner, counting down time to impact. The two upper screens read 10 seconds, the two lower screens exactly 1 minute behind. Alexei kept his eyes on the upper screens, shifting to the real-time satellite view when each of the missiles' video feeds blanked out and their timers reached zero. On the larger screen, there were brilliant flashes, but from within the red circles identifying the targets, huge plumes of dust billowed into the atmosphere as the warheads detonated well below the surface. Millions of tons of pulverized rock, steel, and hardened concrete blasted into the atmosphere, creating a 200-foot-deep crater for the follow-on missile to strike. Mount Weather and Cheyenne Mountain had both been constructed at the height of the Cold War, but when they were built, neither the U.S. nor the Soviet Union possessed the technology to build penetrator missiles. The two bunkers were intended to provide a survivable environment that could withstand a direct surface strike from a Soviet ICBM, not a subterranean detonation within the protective rock that surrounded them. Mount Weather was breached and completely destroyed by the first penetrator. The second missile, when it arrived, wasn't needed. Cheyenne Mountain, carved out of solid rock, fared better from the first strike. Electricity was knocked out, and numerous cave-ins killed dozens of personnel, but the hard Colorado granite held. Until the second penetrator arrived. The stone that had withstood the first missile had cracked from the unimaginable force of the nuclear explosion. The second penetrator dove into the crater created by the first, impacting the fractured rock and burrowing deep into the mountain before detonating. Every living thing within the bunker ceased to exist less than half a second after detonation. A cheer sounded in the conference room as more plumes of dust obscured the satellite view of the two targets. There were no iconic mushroom clouds since the detonations were below ground, but even on the monitor it was obvious that dust and debris were being thrown all the way into the upper atmosphere.
"Congratulations, Comrade President,"
Air Marshal Kuchenko said from across the table, standing to address Baranov.
"With your permission, I will have the technicians adjust our view so we can watch the next phase."
Baranov nodded, and Kuchenko turned and barked orders to the three Russian Air Force captains, seated at a side table laden with computers. A moment later, the giant screen blinked, then displayed a single image. They were looking directly down onto Canada and the northern United States, the extreme upper edge of the display showing the polar ice cap. Flying in formation over Canada, nearly into U.S. airspace, were 1,200 Sukhoi and MiG fighters, 200 aerial tankers for refueling, and nearly 200 transport planes. Looking like toys on the display, everyone in the room knew that the cargo planes were the massive Antonov AN-124 aircraft, loaded with troops, helicopters, and supplies for the invading army. In 2001, Baranov had acquired the Antonov Aircraft Manufacturing Enterprise and had been building the massive planes, capable of lifting nearly a quarter more weight than the venerable American C-5A Galaxy, preparing for this day. Every man in the invasion, as well as three-quarters of the Russian population, had been vaccinated against the virus that had been unleashed on the Americans. He smiled as he watched his planes enter American territory unopposed. Chapter 4. Two of the Russian Mi-28 Havoc strike helicopters exploded in midair, along with one of the Apaches before our pilot reacted. A Havoc was coming down the river straight for us, and he spun us into a nosedive for the water, flaring and jinking to the left at the last second. A missile streaked by close enough that it seemed I could touch it. Then we were gaining altitude and turning so fast I was pinned at the end of my safety tether. A moment later, a Hellfire missile leapt off the right pylon with a roar, tracked the Havoc for a couple of seconds, and detonated as it impacted the Russian's tail rotor. The back half of the Hilo sheared off, the remainder of the aircraft spinning out of control and crashing into the Mississippi River. The pilot continued to fly an evasive pattern, and I crawled my way to the door-mounted minigun and started trying to strap in. Blanchard saw what I was doing and made his way across the tilted deck to help. Finally secured in place, I grabbed the headphones Crawford held out to me and slapped them on my head.
"Come on, you fucking bastard, hold still for Daddy!"
I heard the pilot's voice over the intercom a moment before another missile roared off its pylon, destroying a Havoc that was pursuing a Blackhawk. Unfortunately, the Russian had launched at the same time we had, the Blackhawk exploding into a ball of fire a heartbeat before the Havoc died. We headed north, following the river, directly towards the main air battle that had quickly developed. I wasn't able to count aircraft, but it looked at first blush like the Russians were getting the worst of it. Roaring under the bridge, we cut speed and suddenly popped straight up a couple of hundred feet, two more missiles streaking away and finding their targets. Another Blackhawk and an Apache exploded, and both fell burning into the tightly packed mass of infected at the eastern entrance to the bridge. Tearing my eyes away from the dogfight, I looked for the train. After a moment, I spotted it rolling west. Whoever was driving, Jackson, I presumed, had the diesels at full throttle. Thick black smoke belched from each of the locomotives, and the train appeared to be rapidly gaining speed as it fled the battle. Two Havocs peeled away from the fight after dropping another Apache into the river, pursuing the speeding train.
Two hostiles going after the train,
I shouted into the intercom. Immediately, the pilot threw us into a stomach-clenching turn, and we accelerated to fall in above and behind the Russians. Ahead, I could see the lead Havoc launch a pair of missiles. I followed their smoke trail with my eyes, holding my breath as they closed on the back of the train. The first missile struck the tracks just behind the rear car. The explosion shredded the metal sides of the car and lifted the rear of it into the air. The second missile arrived, slamming into the undercarriage. Bodies, body parts, and metal shards flew in every direction as it disintegrated. Four missiles sped away from the Blackhawk, two for each Havoc. The Russian closest to us reacted almost instantly, pulling up and to the right while deploying magnesium flares in an attempt to decoy the missiles away. As he tried to evade the attack, he kept pulling through his turn, speed bleeding off, and lined up beautifully with a Blackhawk's open side door. I had a perfect sight picture on him and squeezed the trigger on the door-mounted minigun and held it down. My aim wasn't as perfect as I thought, red tracers flying underneath the desperately maneuvering helo. But I kept firing and adjusted until I pumped a couple of hundred slugs into the helicopter. Engine knocked out and black smoke billowing, he started falling, and I turned my attention back to the train just as the other two missiles impacted the lead Havoc and blew it out of the sky. Dodging around the plume of smoke from the destroyed helicopter, we caught up with the train. All that remained of the rear car was a few feet of the steel frame at the front, still in its wheels and coupled to the next car. I wondered how many people that Russian pilot had just killed, but put the thought out of my head as we spun around and headed back east. I leaned forward as far as possible, trying to see ahead of us, but I couldn't get a view of the battle we'd left behind to save the train. Tilting my head back, I hoped for a view out the windscreen, but couldn't see around Colonel Crawford, whose broad back completely blocked the narrow access into the cockpit. I wanted to ask what was going on, but since I didn't need that information at the moment, I decided to stay off the intercom and not distract the pilots. Instead, I busied myself with checking over the minigun to make sure it would be ready when needed. Satisfied with its status, I leaned forward and scanned all of the sky that I could see. No other aircraft were visible, ours or Russian. Our direction and speed changed a few moments later, and I found myself looking down at the Havoc I had shot up. The helicopter was sitting in a rice paddy at a severe tilt, rotors slowly turning and black smoke billowing from the destroyed engine. I knew helicopters that lost power could uncouple their rotor from the engine and let the airflow of their fall spin the rotor and slow them down so they would have a relatively soft landing. This is called autorotation, and my best guess was the Russian pilot had pulled it off. Three Russians stood in knee-deep water 100 feet from their downed aircraft, heads tilted up, watching us as we orbited the crash site. I tracked them with a minigun, hand on the trigger, ready to reduce them to pulp if they did anything I didn't like.
"Hold fire," I heard Crawford's voice over the headset. "We're gonna have a chat with our visitors."
We orbited two more times, then stabilized into a hover with the side of the Blackhawk with a minigun towards them. I held them in my sights as we landed 50 yards away, the pilot keeping the rotor spinning at full speed.
"Major, you and the captain switch places and let's go greet the Russians," Crawford ordered.
Blanchard stepped up and quickly unstrapped me. When I could move freely, I vacated the door gunner spot, and the captain quickly slipped in and gripped the minigun. I strapped him into place and looked around for the colonel. He was standing behind me, holding out an M4 rifle. Grabbing it, I pulled the sling over my head and dropped the magazine to check the load. Satisfied, I slipped it back into place, made sure a round was chambered, and set the selector to burst mode. A quick pat check of my vest to make sure I still had spare magazines on my body, and I was ready to go. Moving to the edge of the cabin, I jumped to the ground, splashing into 2 feet of water, and stepping forward to make room for Crawford. Rifle up and sighted on the three Russians, I heard the colonel splash to the ground. He stepped next to me and raised his rifle. He started wading towards the waiting men.
"How did we fare?" I asked as we walked, referring to the air battle. "All the Russians are down. We lost 11 aircraft."
As he spoke, an Apache roared into a hover 100 yards to the left of the enemy soldiers, chain gun trained on their position. Moving across the flooded rice paddy wasn't easy. Footing was slippery, and the uneven ground beneath the water kept us from moving very fast. Treading carefully, we cross the open space, spreading apart as we approach the men, and finally stopping a dozen feet from where they stood waiting. My rifle was up and trained on the senior man present, a captain if my memory of Russian insignia and rank was correct. He stood holding his left arm tight across his body, the limb obviously broken. He bled from numerous cuts on his face. The other two were a sergeant of some rank and an enlisted man that I guessed was the equivalent of a corporal or specialist in our army. Each of them was banged up and bloody, but neither seemed to have any broken bones.
"Do you speak English?"
Crawford addressed the officer. He glared back for a moment before nodding his head.
"Good. Then you'll understand this. I'm Colonel Jack Crawford of the United States Army, and you are my prisoner. Any resistance or failure to immediately cooperate, and I'll put a bullet in your head. I don't give a fuck about the Geneva Convention. Do you understand?"
The Russian's eyes shifted from Crawford to me, looking down the barrel of my rifle, which was solidly trained on his face. He glanced up at the hovering Apache before turning his attention back to the colonel.
"Da, I understand."
He spoke in surprisingly good English. Chapter 5. Captain Lee Roach struck the surface of the Mississippi at a bad angle, getting the wind knocked out of him. He plunged deep, but didn't try to swim or reach the air. The shock of the first impact, then the cold of the water had stunned him, slowing his racing mind. Water that was at first cold was now comforting, and for a moment Roach didn't care if he lived or not. But like any predator, he was first and foremost a survivor, and eventually started stroking towards the light. Breaching the surface, he looked around for the bitch, but didn't see her or the damn dog anywhere. Just steel-gray water in every direction. The current was strong, the river swollen from the storms upstream, and he was swiftly carried south. Something bumped hard into his back, and turning his head, he saw a wooden shipping pallet floating low in the water. Grabbing on, he was able to pull his upper body onto the pallet, grasping each edge and shifting until he was balanced. The wood sank a few inches deeper into the river, then its buoyancy overcame the added weight of Roach's body, and he rested as the mighty river swept him along. It wasn't long before the sound of high explosive ordnance reached his ears. Using his legs as a rudder, he was able to steer the pallet into a spin in time to see the midspan of the bridge collapse onto the river. Relieved to have escaped, but frustrated that he hadn't had time to play with a bitch, Roach relaxed and watched the shoreline slip by. He guessed the river was moving him at 4 or 5 miles an hour and decided to stay in the water no more than an hour. He wanted to get away from the Major, but not too far. It wasn't long before he heard a helicopter approaching, but there was nothing he could do, caught in the current in the middle of the river. But the helicopter never came as far downstream as he was floating. Spinning the pallet, he watched it hovering, a long rope dangling into the water. After a moment, the aircraft rose and headed for the western shore, a figure clinging to the end of the line. Was it the bitch? Had she survived the fall? He couldn't tell. Then the pallet spun again, and he lost sight of the rescue. He entered a sharp bend and started paddling and kicking frantically as the current took him within a dozen yards of the eastern shore, which was lined with a wall of infected. Coming out of the curve, the river immediately bent again, the current sweeping him close to the western shore. This time he paddled and kicked, aiming for a sandbar that stuck out into the water. When he realized he couldn't free the pallet from the force of the water, he slipped off and swam as hard as he could, angling for the sand. He had a bad couple of moments when it looked like he was going to be swept past his goal, but suddenly he was out of the pull of the current and able to swim the final few yards. Crawling onto the dry sand, he collapsed face down and rested. Catching his breath, he lifted his head at the sounds of an aerial battle to the north. Who the hell was fighting? Roach was curious, but not too curious, standing up and running across the sand to the shoreline, where he disappeared into a narrow strip of trees growing along the edge of the river. Pausing, he checked himself over, dismayed to find he had lost every weapon other than a small 4-inch folding pocket knife tucked into a pouch on the vest he still wore. Roach pushed through the trees and came up against the slope of a tall levee. He crawled up it, cautiously poking his head above the edge to look around. To the south, a few hundred yards, sunlight glinted off the windshield of a vehicle. It was too far away to make out details, but it was sitting on the gravel roadway that ran along the top of the levee, and Roach needed transportation. He knew his limitations in walking across open country, living off what he found and fighting the infected with a 4-inch pocket knife was not something he even imagined he was capable of doing. Following the river south, he walked along the lowest edge of the levee to stay hidden from any of the vehicle's occupants. When he thought he'd covered enough distance, he slowly crawled to the top and looked around. His estimation had been good, and he was pleased to find that he had walked past the vehicle's position by only 10 yards. As he hid in the weeds and surveyed the area, he detected a faint electronic beeping sound. Carefully, he looked all around, but couldn't identify the source of the noise. Ignoring the sound for the moment, Roach concentrated on the vehicle. It was a fairly new 4-wheel-drive Ford pickup, painted white with an orange lensed light bar on top. A large spotlight penetrated the roof in front of the light bar, two smaller ones sticking out from the pillars on either side of the windshield. The truck was facing north, the passenger side towards Roach, and in big red letters on the door closest to him, he read, St. Francis Levee District, official use only. When Roach saw the lettering, he smiled. No one was going to be checking on the levees after everything that had happened. What was the point? Even if they found a major problem, there wasn't anyone left to fix it. This truck had to have been abandoned, or maybe the driver got infected and wandered off. Regardless, his usual good luck was back. He just found the transportation he needed to survive. Climbing to his feet, he fished out the folding knife, flicked it open, and carefully walked to the truck. As he approached, the beeping sound grew louder, the source becoming apparent when he was close enough to see the driver's door standing open. Smiling again, he trotted the rest of the way, hopped into the cab, and closed the door, silencing the alert tone for keys having been left in the ignition. Roach twisted the key and the truck's engine rumbled to life. A quick scan of the dash showed he had a nearly full tank of gas. Now, where to go? The road on the top of the levee was narrower than the truck was long, so there was no way to turn around and go back. That meant there was either a turnaround on ahead or a way off the levee. Shifting into drive, Roach accelerated down the gravel road, keeping his speed low to prevent creating a dust plume that could be seen for miles in the flat terrain. As he drove, Roach kept an eye on the river below, hoping to spot the bitch. If she was in the water, he didn't know how he'd get to her, but he still wanted to feel her squirm under his hands as he violated her in every way imaginable. Chapter 6. Rachel came out of unconsciousness with a start, face down in mud. She was cold, shivering, her body screaming in protest when she tried to roll over. Her head pounded and every inch of her ached, making her catch her breath and stop trying to move. Slowly, she gently started moving different parts, just a couple of inches, testing for injury. When everything seemed to move okay, even though it hurt to even wiggle a finger, she steeled herself for the pain and rolled onto her back. She wanted to cry out, but bit down on her lip and stayed silent. With no idea if they were infected close by, she wasn't about to announce her presence. Lying there, Rachel managed to get her breathing under control and looked up at the night sky. Night? It had been early morning, the last thing she could remember. What was the last thing she remembered? The train derailing, fighting through the infected as they ran for the bridge. The terrifying helicopter flight back to get the train, driving the train to the bridge, then being attacked by Roach. Roach. Rachel involuntarily sat up in fear, stifling a groan of pain as she wrapped her arms around her bruised body. Dealing with the pain, she looked around frantically, terrified that she would see Roach standing there with a smile and a knife. Not seeing any immediate threats, she climbed onto her knees and slowly raised her head up to survey her surroundings. She was kneeling on a narrow strip of mud, the waters of the Mississippi lapping against the bank only inches from her feet. The shoreline was on the outside edge of a sharp bend in the river, and Rachel could only assume the current had washed her onto the bank. But where was she? How far downstream had the river taken her before mercifully depositing her in the mud? And which side of the river was she on? The sun wasn't up to tell her east from west, but as Rachel sat there shivering, she realized all she had to do was look at the river. As she faced it, it flowed from her left to right, which put her on the western bank. Thank God for that small mercy. She didn't know how many infected were on the west side of the river, but she sure knew how many were to the east. Dog. Where was Dog? His rescue of Rachel from Roach's knife was what had knocked all of them off the train and into the water below. Where the hell was he? And why hadn't John found her? Rachel felt herself slipping into despair and mentally chastised herself. She didn't have time to feel sorry for herself or worry about why something hadn't happened. Even if they weren't right on top of her, they were likely infected in the area, and she needed to start thinking and acting before she became a late-night snack. Checking her holster, she breathed a sigh of relief to find the pistol still firmly secured to her body.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.